Good morning. This morning's speaker is our very own Elder Jonathan Chow, and he will be speaking on God's calling on the young Samuel. As I shared with you in my message last week, God appears to people through what we call special revelation, directly to Moses or to Samuel in this morning's message. But he also speaks to us. He reveals himself to us through what we call general revelation, through the reading of the Bible, particularly prayer, through people, and even life events. If you have felt discouraged recently, I want you to know that God is near. God is close to us. He desires for us to seek him, but he is also close to us. I'd like to read to you Psalm chapter 34, verses 17 and 18. When the righteous cry for help, the Lord hears and delivers them out of their troubles. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit. The Bible reminds us that God is indeed near. He is not far. Let us seek him in worship and fellowship and prayer this morning. Have a great worship service.
Draw me close to you. My desire. down on my knees again, surrendering all, surrendering all. Find me here, Lord, as you draw me near, desperate for you, desperate for you. And I surrender. Drench my soul, drench my soul, as mercy and grace unfold. My hunger and thirst, my hunger and thirst. With arms stretched wide, I know you hear my cry. Speak to me now, speak to me. And I surrender, I surrender. And I want to know you more, and I want to know you more. I surrender, and I surrender. And I want to know you. I want to know you more. Like a rushing wind, Jesus breathes. Like a rushing wind, like a rushing wind, Jesus breathe within. Lord, have your way, Lord, have your way in me. Like a mighty storm, stir within my soul. Lord, have your way. thousand stories on one day. In your light I'm heard, a tender whisper of loving. The dead are dying, you tell me. Then your peace and
dear brothers and sisters in the Ministry Fellowship, I'm very glad and being honored to speak to you again this morning. Let's bow our head and have a word of prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, we come before you. We ask you to open our ears so that we can listen. We ask you to open our hearts so that we understand, so that our life will be changed by your word. We ask you, your Holy Spirit, to be with each of us today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There was a CEO want to see if anyone pay attention to what he said. So he decided to do an experiment, an interesting experiment himself. Okay, at the company annual meeting, he stood at the doorstep and greet everyone as usual, except unlike any other day, he did not say, oh, the routine things. Oh, welcome, welcome. He shook hands with each guest and repeated this word with a smile. I murdered my grandmother this morning. Upon hearing those words, what do you think? Most of the guests responded with a smile and said, oh, is that so? Oh, how lovely. Or what they would say, oh, just continue with your great work. And they walk away into the reception room. Among the hundreds of invited guests, only one, a banker, got what the CEO said. He smiled and replied, oh, Mr. CEO, is that so? Then she must have deserved it. Truly, most people do not listen closely. What they hear is only what they think ought to be heard, not what was actually said. Sometimes, even worse, when they do hear, they may give an unexpected response to what he said. A lot of times, we hear, but not listen. Like a child, we cover our ears and refuse to listen. Refuse to listen to others. Refuse to listen to your parents. Refuse to listen to your spouse. Refuse to listen to your teachers. I hope you listen to Pastor Eugene. Do we respond to what God says the same way? When we seek God, do we just hear what we think we ought to be heard? When we really hear God speak to us, do we respond accordingly? Or do we just stay unmoved with no action? At times, do we even complain that God does not speak to us? Dear brothers and sisters, what's the problem? What's the problem? The problem lies within us. Today, in 1 Samuel chapter 3, the passage where God speaks to Samuel, we will learn two things. Who will God talk to? How can we hear God? Okay. After the message, I want you to answer two questions. Who will God talk to? Like to talk to? How can we hear God? Two questions. In verse 1-4 of 1 Samuel chapter 3, he says, the boy Samuel ministered before the Lord under Eli. In those days, the word of the Lord was rare. There was not that many visions. One night, Eli, whose eyes were becoming so weak that he could barely see, was lying down in his usual place. The Lamb of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord, where the Ark of God was. Then the Lord called Samuel. From 1-4, verse 1-4, we see two characters. Samuel, a young boy serving in the temples, and another person, Eli, an old man, an old high priest of the temple. Okay, if you were to ask, if I ask you, which one would God choose to talk to? What would you say? What would you say? If I ask you, Samuel or Eli, which one would God choose to talk to? If I'm being asked, definitely I will say Eli. Why? Even though his eyes become so weak and that he could barely see, but we can see consider by experience, Eli was what? Much more than Samuel, as Chinese or saying or your parents said, Eli has eaten more, much more salt than Samuel has eaten rice. Of course, there's no rice at that time, but he has much more experience, right? And by knowledge, Eli has definitely learned Torah and the teachings of the prophets, whereas Samuel was just a little boy and know nothing. And status, Eli was a high priest, and while Samuel was only a servant boy. So, in our eyes, it's not possible that God did not talk to Eli, but talk to a boy, Samuel. Why didn't God talk to Eli? Why the word of the law was so rare in those days? First of all, we need to understand the background of this passage. Okay. At that time, the Israelites were living under the judges at that time. It was the darkest period in their history. Everyone did what was right in his own eyes. Even the priests who served God were greedy and corrupt. They lived in indulgence. In 1 Samuel chapter 2, it says even Eli's two sons were priests of God. They not only took the meat, we were supposed to give it to the one that who offered sacrifice. They not only taking the meat from others, they even worse, they took something belonged to God, the fat from the offering. Eli, their father, heard what happened, what they did. And he came to them, came to talk to them. But they would not listen still and continue their way, their own way. Even so, Eli did not exercise his power as a father and as a high priest to discipline them and to stop them, to strip them of their duties as priest. He didn't do it. And God, what did God do? And it seems that God wants to make sure Eli knows what he's doing. He rebuked him. He sent a messenger to rebuke Eli. In chapter 2, verse 29, why do you honor your sons more than me? That's what God said. God even proclaimed to Eli that his judgment would come. And then what happened? What happened? In the end, not only did Eli's son not repent, nor did Eli respond to God's proclamation at all. It was as though Eli did not hear God. He just carried on like what nothing happened. So what happened afterward? Since then, God did not talk to Eli. And God did not talk to men anymore at that time. Dear brothers and sisters, God does not speak. God does not speak, not because he does not want to talk to man. It's because men do not want to listen to him. I repeat, God does not speak, not because he does not want to talk to man. It's because of men do not want to listen to him. Take a look. The world around us today. God's word is also rare. Everyone does what is right in his own eyes. Everyone acts according to his own will. For example, in marriage, God's will is for the marriage between a man and a woman, a husband and a wife, for their entire life. Yet, one ignores that. They just do whatever they like. They please. A man can marry a man. A woman can marry a woman. As long as they love one another, they can do it anyway. One just can divorce anytime as one wish, one wants. Actually, right now, divorce rate may be lower because of people living together without getting married. People just say, oh, this is my personal things. Okay, nothing, it's not none of your business. Yes, they only care about, okay, it's my freedom, it's my right. Okay, they only care about the life now and here, here and now. They don't care. They don't care about their meaning of life, the eternity, the judgment. Everyone is acting according to his own will, doing what they like. Dear brothers and sisters, do we hear God's voice in this age of doing as one pleases? Do we hear God's voice? If not, is there something in our life we need to repent? Do we only have thoughts about money, sex, and power, and success? Just keep us busy? Have our eyes seen anything we shouldn't have? Have our ears taken pleasure in hearing slanders? Have our mouth spoken hurtful words? Have our hands indulged in lust? Have our hearts ever not desired God, not love others, or even hate others? Dear brothers and sisters, right at this moment, let's examine ourselves before our just and holy God. Have we ever rejected God's rebuke? Have we ever hardened our hearts, not listened to God's warning? God does not speak, not because God doesn't want to speak to us. It's because men do not want to listen to God. Actually, God wants to speak to some people to reveal his will. In the passage that we read, Samuel is the one that God spoke to. Why? Why did God speak to Samuel, not Eli? Of course, certainly, God has the right to speak whomever he wants to, right? But in the passage of chapter 3, verse 4 to 10, we can see that Samuel has some special qualities or characters that please God. So God spoke to him. Okay, let's see. Let's read verse 4 to 10. Then the Lord called Samuel. Samuel answered, "Here I am." Okay. And he ran to Eli and said, "Here I am. You call me?" But Eli said, "I did not call. Go back and lie down." So he went and lay down. Okay, this is the first time God speak to Samuel. And verse 6, again the Lord called Samuel. And Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, you call me?" "My son," he said. Eli said, "I did not call, go back and lie down." The second time that God called Samuel, verse 7, now Samuel did not know the Lord. The word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel a third time. Okay, third time. And Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am. You call me?" Then Eli realized that the Lord was calling the boy. So Eli told Samuel, "Go and lie down. And if he calls you, say, "Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening." So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Verse 10, the Lord came and stood there, calling as at the other time, "Samuel, Samuel." Then Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." In this passage, we can see Samuel was a fat boy. How do we know Samuel was a fat boy? Okay, he's not physical fat. In God's eyes, Samuel was a fat boy because he's a faithful, he's available, and he's teachable. Faithful, stand with F. Available, start with A. And teachable, T-F-A-T. We see God call Samuel three times. And for three times, Samuel fought Eli call without being annoyed. Samuel jumped out from, I can imagine, he jumped out from his warm bed three times to report to Eli and say, "Here I am." We can see his faithfulness. We can see his available, always standing by. In the fourth time, when God said, "Call Samuel," indeed, Samuel followed Eli's instruction to respond to God, saying, "Speak, for your servant is listening." He has a teachable and humble heart. Dear brothers and sisters, in the eyes of God, ask ourselves, am I a fat boy or a fat man or a fat girl or a fat woman? Am I faithful? Am I a faithful person? Think for a bit. Are you? Let's take a look at our lives and apply the standard of the world on what faithful means. Suppose you are the boss, you are the manager, consider your employee or subordinate. Okay, if he does not show up for work once every 2 weeks, would you consider him faithful? Of course not, right? If he just does the minimal and just, okay, this is not what I'm supposed to do. Okay, you do it. Okay, would you consider him faithful? No. If he does things half-hearted, just barely doing barely minimal, just up to just finish it, okay, make it work, and then without thinking twice, would you consider him faithful? No. Let's look at ourselves. If we show up, the worship once in a while, do you think that God consider you faithful? You answer yourself. If we just do the minimum at church, okay, serve at church, do you think that God consider you faithful? Okay, you answer yourself. If we serve the Lord half-hearted, okay, what do you think? Would God consider you faithful? I tell you the truth. A lot of us still here and not being fired. Okay, fired. And still can serve. Not because you are faithful. Not because we are faithful. But because of God's grace and mercy. He gave us chance. Another chance to serve. So that we learn to be faithful. Of course, you can say, I'm volunteer. I'm volunteer. Okay, what do you expect from me? Okay, but do we see that we are serving to whom we are serving? We are serving God, the Almighty God, the Holy God. We are God's servant. Do we need to be faithful? Do we need to be faithful? Yes, we do. Not only God speak to you, faithful person, but God speak to you, those who are available to stand by always. A heart of constant standby is a heart of ever readiness. But we are too busy these days. Yeah, busy is a symbol of impartiveness at this time. Okay, so we keep busy. But while we are busy, we can't listen well. We cannot discern. We cannot even hear God speak. Do we? Back when the telegraph was the fastest method of long-distance communication, a young man applied for a job as a Morse code operator. Answering an ad in the newspaper, he went to the office and applied the job, and then he see a sign, okay, and asking to fill out the application form and put there and then wait until someone to call to enter the office and to have an interview. Okay, the young man finished all those and sat with another seven applicants in the waiting area. And then after a few minutes, that the young man got up and went into the room. Oh, the other seven people, men, just wonder, why? They ask them one another, do you hear anything? All of them say, no, I didn't hear. So they thought, okay, this young man must fail because he make a mistake and he would be disqualified. But within a few minutes, the employer came out with the young man and said, oh, gentlemen, thank you very much for coming, but the job has been filled. Oh, the other applicants start grumbling to each other and one spoke up and saying, wait a minute, I don't understand. He was the last one to come in and we never got a chance to be interviewed, yet he got the job. That's not fair. The employer said, oh, I'm sorry, but all the time you have been sitting here, the telegraph has been taking out the foreign message in Moscow. If you understand this message, then came right in. The job is yours. None of you heard it and understood that this young man did. The job is his. Brother and sister, do we hear? Are we really busy and do not hear God speak to us? We are distracted a lot of time. God speak to us through his word, through other people. But do we hear God speak to us? Are we tuned in to God's voice? Do we hear him when he speak? Are we listening? Dear brother and sister, do you want to hear God's voice? Let's pause from our business. Let's turn off our radio while we are driving. Okay, let's turn off our TV and maybe your computer at home. Let's turn off especially your cell phone. Let's pray. Let's tune in to God's channel and listen to him. He speaks to us. A heart of constant standby is also a heart of waiting. Not only we pause in our daily life, not being busy, but also waiting before the Lord. Okay, but with this, with our instant culture, we have instant noodle, we have instant milk. We have everything instant. We want everything to be fast. Our scripture, okay, read in 3 minutes and our prayer in 2 minutes. And we done our devotion. Okay. And a lot of times, we just do it, so that, we won't feel guilty, especially, Pastor Eugene, when he asks you, how is your devotion? Oh, yeah, I did it. And a lot of times, I think we say hi and bye to God. And a lot of times, many times I picture God appears to be saying, wait, don't go. I'm still talking to you. I still have things to say to you. Dear brothers and sisters, when we read the scripture, have we heard God speak to us through the Bible? When we pray, have we wished God to speak to us? I think a lot of times we read the Bible because of just obligation. We pray because, oh, we are Christians, so we need to pray, but we don't wait to listen to God. Besides having the heart of faithfulness and available, standby always. In order to hear God's voice, we also need to have a teachable, humble heart. When we think we can manage on our own, we can do things ourselves, we cannot hear God's voice. When we think we know everything. God, just step aside. Let me do it. We cannot hear God's voice. When we boast, we cannot hear God's voice either. Dear brothers and sisters, are you willing to have a teachable, humble heart to learn? A young man worked at a supermarket. Okay. On the first day, his manager welcomed him with a big smile and shook his hand warmly. Then the manager gave him a broom and said, your first task is to clean the store inside out. Wow, the young man said annoyingly, don't you know that I'm college grad? The manager then said, oh, I'm sorry. I don't know you are a college grad. Oh, okay. Let me have the broom and I show you how to sweep. Brothers and sisters, let's pray to God to help us be a FAT person in his eyes so that we can hear him speak. Besides being a FAT person in God's eyes, in verse 11 to 18, we can also see Samuel has another attribute that pleases God and make God want to talk to him. That's reference to God and obedience to God. In this passage from 11 to 18, God proclaimed his judgment on Eli's family when he talked to Samuel. In verse 11, God says, see, I am about to do something in Israel that will make the ears of everyone who hears of it tingle. As C.S. Lewis once said, God whisper to us in our prayers, speak to us in our conscience, but shouts in our pains. Yes, in our prayers, God speaks gently to us, gently to us and teach us. In our struggles, God, in his kind voice, comfort us and guide us. But when we sin and we're drawn into the pain of sin, God shouts his warning to us. God shouts. Even though God is warning so bad and so heavy and the judgment was so harsh, what was Eli's response? Was he obedient to God or was he rebellious to God? he seems to be obedient to God. And he seemed to be so reverent to God. He said, "Oh, whatever God want, let God's will be done." Okay, whatever God said. Okay, He is the law. Let Him. He is the law. Let Him do what is good in His eyes. That's his response. But Eli didn't understand the proclamation of the judgment. It's not for punish to the for it's not to punish him. The purpose of the judgment is to have Eli's return to him, to repent. Eli didn't repent on God's rebuke. He didn't understand the purpose of God's punishment was for him to return to the Lord. He just maintained, "Let it be attitude." Okay, He is the law. He's my boss. Okay, let him do whatever he wants. He appears to be obedient to God. He appeared to reverence to God, but actually, he rebels against God's will. He showed contempt to God. Let's look at Samuel. Okay. He references to God and he obeys to God. When Eli asks him, okay, what God said to him, he has two options. One was to tell the truth and the other was not to tell. Tell and not tell. Actually, it would be much easier not to tell the truth because no one knows it except God. But he chose to tell the truth. Okay, he told Eli what God said to him. Why? Why? Actually, it's much easier to lie to him. Nobody knows. If he tell the truth, what's the risk? Eli will kick him out. Oh, okay. Maybe. But why did Samuel willingly stick out his neck and risk? Because he fears God. He cannot tell lies because he's obedient to God. He's faithful to God in delivering his message to Eli, even when the words were hard to swallow for Eli. Brothers and sisters, selective obedience is not obedience at all. So it's only a convenience. When God puts a period, do not change it to a question mark. Do we have selective obedience? When God tells us, you must have God, you must love God and one another, what will you say? Do we only love those who are deserving our love? Our love for God is a conditional. We love God more than when we love God when times are when we are prosper, when times are good, and we love God less when we are in trouble or when times are rough. Dear friends, when God speaks to us, will we put a question mark at the end? God says, "I love you," period. Would you say, "You love me?" Question mark. God says, "God loved man so that he sent his only son to them, so all who believe in him will not perish, but will have everlasting life." Would you say, "Wow, it's too good to be true. What's the catch?" Dear brothers and sisters, we need to have a heart of fearing God and obedience to God as God wants to talk to us. Dear brothers and sisters, when we are willing to repent our sins, when we become FAT person, when we reference to God and obey God, then we can hear God. Just as in verse 19 to 21 says, God wants to be with us. He wants to give us more of his word. Have you seen the commercial? There's a man who asks at every steps he takes, can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? Actually, I think this, what God is doing to us, he always say to you, can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? Brothers and sisters, let's repent. Let's be a FAT person in good eyes, in God's eyes. Let's reference to God and obey him. We will we will hear his voice. At this moment, let's stop here and pray to God and say, Lord, speak to me. Your servant is listening. Lord, speak to me. I'm listening. Your servant is listening. Let's have a word of prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, we are here. We are here to listen to you. We are your servant. Father, show us. Show us your love, your holiness, so that we cleanse ourselves, we come to you, we draw near to you, so that we hear you. So that your spirit talk to us and touch us. Father, thank you. Thank you for the time that you be with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All right, three announcements this morning before we leave. Our first is the 11 o'clock discussion class. We are continuing our series on what is worship. This morning you'll be watching a short clip by Pastor Francis Chan, who will be sharing about visiting the underground church in China and their worship service and how they view Americans' Christianity. I think you'll find it surprising as well as eye-opening. I'll be talking about body language as well today. Hope you'll join us for that. Our second announcement is for our teens. This coming Friday on the 17th, we will be meeting again in person. Join us at 7:30 at church in person for fellowship this Friday for our teens. Our third announcement is I'm looking for some volunteers who would like to help us to be a part of our Sunday editing team for our online editing team, as well as scripture reading and some other things. If you'd like to serve, please contact me and we can talk and see if there's something that can work out. We appreciate your help at this time. All right, for those of you leaving, may God bless you. May you be a blessing to others this week. Hope to see you at 11 o'clock. See you soon. Take care.